excited you're here. And if you wish to receive CE hours for this session, please be sure to write your name down. There's a piece of paper right up on this front chair, or you can feel free to email us at sphalum@umn.edu. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you, Megan. Can you all hear me? Is that going to work if I just talk loudly? And if you start to not be able to hear me, please let me know. I'm also very hard of hearing, so if you have questions or if I ask a question and you answer back, if I walk up to you, just know it's because I'm very hard of hearing. So I was in the School of Public Health for about 30 years here at the university. I just retired last year, and so it's nice to be able to actually work with the Alumni Association. So I'm going to talk to you about water. Most people in public health, when they hear water, they think drinking water. And that's fine, but it's a very complicated story, even if we just dealt with drinking water and we talked about what are the challenges around drinking water and what are the solutions around drinking water, it gets very complicated. And so I have a couple of take-home points that I want to make with this lecture and then the Q&A, and that has to do with really thinking about water beyond drinking water. If you're only thinking drinking water, I'm going to, by the end of this, you're going to be thinking broader. And then in terms of the class goals, to understand the complexity of water systems. Water systems involve both groundwater and surface water. I'm sure you think of them separately. 99.9% of the world does, but I will convince you that they're actually all one system. The other thing has to do with quantity and quality of water. We often just focus on quantity over here and quality over here. I'm a chemist. I spent my whole career doing quality stuff. But quantity, it turns out, matters a great deal. And then finally, understanding that it's not just humans that use water for drinking water and for other uses, but in fact, ecosystem uses of water and animal and wildlife use of water is also very important to public health. So keep all those in mind. And then finally, I want you to appreciate that all of these aspects of water ultimately do relate back to public health. So just a refresher for those of you that may not know about the hydrologic cycle. So most of the Earth's surface is covered in water. 75%, 70% of the Earth's surface is our oceans. And the ocean water evaporates because of sunlight. It eventually comes back down as rain and snow and fog and other kinds of precipitation. It hits the land surface as well as the ocean surface. And it collects in our rivers and our lakes, and then flows back ultimately to the ocean, or it sinks into the groundwater. The simplest way to think about the hydrologic cycle is this. It's a cycle. It's constantly going. And in Minnesota, it's kind of interesting. We benefit greatly from this whole source of precipitation. All the surface water in Minnesota, all of our water that we receive in Minnesota is from the atmosphere. It's from rain and snow. We don't get water from anywhere else. We don't have rivers that flow into Minnesota, right? All our rivers flow out of the state. So we start with really clean water, which is a big benefit for Minnesota. But I wanted to point out that it's a cycle and that it's a finite amount of water. This water, when it evaporates and comes back down, you don't lose any of this. It's all one cycle, but it's finite. You can't add to it. You don't take away from it. So on the planet Earth, most of our water, we are the water planet, after all, most of our water is saline in the oceans and in other parts of the planet, but it's saline. Only 3% of the water on Earth is fresh water, and the vast majority of that is not available. It's frozen in the ice caps, the polar regions, or it's locked up in very deep groundwater. And so only a little bit of water, less than 1% of that 3%, is actually available fresh water. So it's pretty precious. It's abundant still. There's enough water for all the people on the planet, but we don't happen to live in all the places where there's water. A lot of people live in places where there isn't much water, so you end up with this conflict over water access. Now, how do we use water? Question for you. I'm just going to just take anybody who raised their hand, call out, how do we use water?
Agriculture.
Sorry, agriculture?
Energy.
Energy, very good. Already said?
Consumption.
Drinking water. Was somebody over here? Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm hard of hearing, so just shout it out.
Recreation.
Manufacturing.
Recreation, perfect.
Manufacturing.
Manufacturing and industrial use.
Household
use, sure. That's drinking water and then home use, residential use.
Mm-hmm.
What else?
Fracking.
So for mineral extraction, for oil and gas, absolutely. You're real close to another one that's related in Minnesota. Aquaculture, did you say? Yes, no one ever gets that one. Excellent. But related to extraction, we're a big state that does...
Mining.
Thank you, mining. Okay.
I think you got most of the major categories. Anybody feeling like I didn't get their category? Okay. Domestic, residential, industrial, mining. I had to push on that one. Electricity. We use a lot of water to cool our electricity generating power stations. Energy in general, so that would include fracking as well as other forms of energy like biofuels. Agriculture was named first. Cultural, recreational, spiritual use of water. And then one thing you didn't mention is ecosystem use of our waters. It's all right. If I had to wait for that one, it might have taken up most of our time. That's a subtle one. And aquaculture was mentioned. And in Minnesota, that's actually a pretty big use of our water. So in the United States, first I'm going to just show you some data on how we use water separated between groundwater and surface water. And what this shows you is the population change in the United States over time, going from 1950 up to not quite present day. And this is the groundwater use, this is the smaller bar. And this bar is the surface water use, and then the total is that tallest bar. So you can see that in the United States, most of our water use is surface water, not groundwater. And it has increased with population up to a point. About the mid-1980s, we saw the population continue to increase, but we did not see an increase in water use. That's good. It has to do with conservation. It has to do with everything from low flow toilet and shower heads to people just being more conservation minded, and certain technology increases there. So that's a good thing. In Minnesota, it's kind of a similar story. We have these data are a little bit, they're parsed a little bit more, they're chunked together a little bit much from 1990 to 2010. But again, surface water is we use more surface water than groundwater in the states. And it's been going up and down, but you can see that we've leveled off. In fact, our residential use of water has decreased over time since about the 1980s. So Minnesota kind of looks like the nation. If you actually look at the categories of use, and that's a very busy slide, but I'll walk you through the important aspects of it. In the United States, the biggest use of water is this big thing here. It's thermoelectric power. It's cooling water to generate electricity from our coal-fired power plants. Biggest use of water. Minnesota, 66% of the water use in Minnesota is for electricity. That's always a big surprise to people. This is not consumed water. Water comes out of the river, cools. Water that's a little hotter goes back into the same river, same spot. So it's not considered consumptive, but it is a water use. And if you look at other water uses, nationally, this big green thing is irrigation. That's agricultural use of water for irrigation. In Minnesota, we have irrigation is here, I believe. That's industrial. Where's irrigation? Here it is, 8.6, I think. Anyway, it's less than 10%. We irrigate far less in Minnesota than the nation does as a whole, because of course this is including all the western states, which irrigate quite a bit. Then you have domestic use is the third biggest category in each case. So you can kind of get a feel for how we use our water. And one of the take-home lessons here is that the energy, the nexus of water and energy is very important. Every time you flip on a light switch, you're using water. And a lot of people don't know that, so this is an important lesson. And if you think about water, you have to think about energy. If you think about water, you have to think about agriculture. If you think about water, you have to think about all kinds of things. And so it's not a single little thing, like it sounds so simple, H2O. So this is our water use in Minnesota over time, 1985 to 2010. The data are always at least 5 years old, sorry. They don't compile them very quickly. And again, thermoelectric use is this big part of the total use, and that has gone up over time. Because our population has gone up over time, our electricity needs have gone up over time, and we don't see conservation there. So our water use in Minnesota for electricity use has continued to increase. But our domestic use of water, and it's kind of hidden in these many colors, has actually gone down a bit. And the use of use for agriculture is, so livestock and irrigation. Irrigation is here. Yeah, and sorry, the colors don't really work so well, do they? Aquaculture is up there. But, irrigation has changed over time. That really depends on everything from the climate and weather systems to food prices to commodity prices, I should say. It goes up and down all the time. So when we were having droughts a few years ago, we saw huge increases in irrigation. So you can, you know, that part of the bar goes up and down depending on all kinds of other external forces. So let me ask, before I get to the next slide, give it away. What do you think the biggest use of water is by you as individuals? So let's talk about, that's all state data and federal data. How about you as individuals? How do you use water? And what do you think your biggest use of water is? Shout it out.
Laundry.
Laundry?
Yes. Shower and toilet.
Okay.
Cleaning, washing dishes, kitchen.
Okay.
Watering. Watering the yard, what watering the
yard? Bingo. Gold star here. Is it? Okay, think big.
Drinking, cooking.
Toilets.
Food, bingo.
Electricity.
Get to that in a minute.
Electricity. Electricity.
Electricity. Yeah, and we don't have a way to measure that. So my guess is that that's a really important use, but it's not pulled. No one has those numbers to pull out, which is an interesting thing, because I just pointed out how important it was. We actually, no one that I know has the data that have pulled it out on a residential level, just industrial. Any others? Okay, so there's something called a water footprint. You're probably familiar with your carbon footprint. Well, we can calculate water footprints. In fact, the industry does this all the time because every time you use water, you're spending money. So the water footprint is easily calculated. There are a couple of calculators on the web. You can just go to waterfootprint.org and you can figure this out for yourself. But first look at the blue. And this is the average water footprint for the United States. Diet is the biggest source of water use. Every time you eat anything, there was water used to make it. And I'm not advocating for any kind of a diet here. I'll simply say that if you eat a lot of meat in your diet, you're kind of a normal diet, eating meat 3 to 7 times a week, you're going to have this very big blue. It takes a lot of water to make a steak, to grow a pig for pork, to even grow chickens for chicken. So it takes a lot of water for this. It takes a lot of water for vegetables, but the higher in the food web, the more water it takes. And so steak is usually at the top of the list because first you had to have a steer and you had to feed it corn, you had to use water to grow the corn. You can see the cascade effect. I don't eat as much meat as the average American, but I'm not a vegetarian. Vegetarian would bring it down a bit, but food. Notice it's the biggest part of your water footprint. The second biggest is energy. This is they pull it out here, but it's kind of based on, and they're making all kinds of assumptions. So it's not based on a calculation. It's based on like the size of your home. So they're assuming a certain electricity footprint, and then they turn that into a water footprint. But it's pretty big. And then there's stuff, and the stuff is things like clothing, iPhones, stuff. They require a lot of water. An iPhone takes a lot of water. It's a good thing that we don't just throw them away all the time. A pair of blue jeans, you know, it takes gallons and gallons and gallons of water to grow the cotton, to make the blue jeans. So I'm wearing a lot of water, I mean, and that's okay, just that you should know that there's water involved. Then there's your home use. I'm kind of typical. I do shower every day. I do wash dishes by hand, and I shouldn't. I, you know, because it uses more water than a dishwasher. But This is interesting because this is the smallest part of your overall water footprint, and it always is. I'm not saying not to pay attention to this. You can control this. You can't control these other things hardly at all. But you can control this. So yes, turn off the water when you brush your teeth. Yes, turn off the lights when you leave a room for lots of different reasons. So you can get to some of the personal things. But I just wanted to bring this back home to individuals and understanding how you use water at home. I mean, in general, I should say. So what are the issues confronting us with water? Why am I even talking about water? Water's in the news every day. California's got a drought. Flint has got a lead problem. Syria is having a horrible, terrible drought. China, 75% of the groundwater in northern China, if you pull it out of the ground and touch it, you will get blisters. Now that's a quality problem. There are problems all over the world with water, and you hear about them every day, right? I mean, you can't look at a newspaper and not find an article related to water. So what are these issues? And I'm going to keep it not at the international level. I'm going to keep it at the state and the national and local level. And Minnesota's problems are exactly what the whole nation faces. We're like a little miniature microcosm of the nation. If you go to Texas, they have like two problems. In Minnesota, we're kind of diverse. We have many different things going on, and we have all the same problems as all of the states combined, essentially. We have a quantity problem, believe it or not. We do not have enough water. We'll talk about that. We have a quality problem. I'll talk about that. Mostly around excess nutrients and around what's called contaminants of emerging concern. We have these issues of the connection of water with land use, as such as in agriculture, the connection of water with energy. And then we have economic issues, which aren't scientific issues. I mean, they're social science issues. And they can get pretty complicated, and they deal with pricing and infrastructure most of the time. And then we have social aspects of governing water. There is no, so for instance, we have a Clean Water Act, but the Clean Water Act has nothing to do with groundwater. We have no federal law dealing with groundwater. Some states have no state law dealing with groundwater. So we have a patchwork of regulatory framework, and so governance of water gets very complicated. In Minnesota, we're a riparian state. The water belongs to the people. In California, water is a water right that you purchase, and if you got it before your neighbor, you get the water and they don't. Very different system by state. So complicated. So managing water becomes a moral issue, an ethical issue, a governance issue. There's a whole lot of issues in that. So let's talk about each of these issues, and I'm going to give you a primer, if you will, on what these issues are and why they're kind of difficult and how they relate. In the end, I'm going to bring it all back together, I hope. Trust me, I was going to say, but I thought, well, only if it works for you. And I'm going to try to bring it all back together at the end. So let's talk about the water supply, and I'm going to talk about Minnesota only, but it applies to the rest of the nation. So we have an increased use of groundwater in the state, and I'll show you some data. We know that the climate change, and we are definitely warming in Minnesota, we have data to show that, is altering the hydrologic cycle for the state. So that cycle I showed you at the beginning is being altered. How much water falls and when it falls is changing in Minnesota as a result of climate change. We have an aging infrastructure, not nearly as catastrophic as Flint's, but we have an aging infrastructure. Hit the wrong button. We need more treatment technologies because I'll talk about why that's the case as well. And now I'm going to show you some data. This is the height of groundwater, okay? So the depth of groundwater, I should say. In an observation well, data from 1943 up to the present. These are data from a site over by Lake Minnetonka, so western suburbs. And you can see that over that 60-year period, we've lost 40 feet of groundwater, steadily. Sometimes there's some droughts, sometimes there isn't. This is just a steady overuse of groundwater. And the ups and downs are summer versus winter. So when we talked about using water for landscaping, yes, this is landscaping. The bottom of these is is summer use. The 3 months of summer, we use 4 times the amount of water that we do when we're not watering that wonderful landscaping that's only there for 3 months. So that's why the sawtooth pattern exists. But the downward decline is simply overuse of groundwater. In the metro area, and this is the 7-county formal metro area, this shows the use of groundwater versus surface water for domestic use from 1940, again, to kind of present day. And what this graph shows is that our proportion of how much water we use that we pull from the ground versus what we pull from the river, from the Mississippi River, has changed drastically over that 60 years. It used to be that most people drank river water, the red, and now most people are drinking groundwater. That's the blue on the far right. 75% of the metro is using groundwater for domestic use. Why is this good or bad? Well, surface water is like a checking account. You get it easy to put money in, easy to take money out. Money comes in monthly, maybe bi-weekly, right? Unless you're retired like me, then there's nothing. No. Groundwater is like a savings account. You're lucky to put stuff in. It goes in slowly. You don't want to be spending it on willy-nilly. You really want to protect that. That's the way this works. Now, why does it work that way? Because it rains all the time in Minnesota. It snows all winter. We get plenty of surface water. We get the deposits to the surface water to the checking account, no problem. We have an infinite supply of surface water. Almost. It's a bad term for scientists to use. Groundwater is your savings account. And we're spending it like crazy. We're spending it instead of our checking account. You know how long it takes to deposit to your savings account? It's water. Hundreds of years for that water that you might get in July, that rainstorm, or the rain we're getting today, it might take 10 years to get to shallow groundwater. Hundreds, if not thousands of years to get to the deep aquifers. If you spend it, it's gone.
Is there any correlation in this between urban settlement and then distribution in the suburbs, and also how's this then look at as our population has increased? So as we look at per capita, we have fewer people in the 40s.
Right.
Again, a larger population.
Excellent question, and the answer is yes. To both. This is on a percentage basis, so it doesn't show the population increase. But what has happened, why did this happen? Well, think about it. When back in here, most of the people lived in the cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul, and their water comes from the Mississippi River. Most of it. That's simplification, but I can say that. The minute we began suburban sprawl to the outer ring suburbs, groundwater's cheap. Man, you just sink a well, pull up the well. Woodbury just sinks a well, just many wells, and distributes it. Way cheaper than trying to bring it from the Mississippi, building a treatment plant, because then you got to treat the water because it's dirtier than groundwater. So every suburb has wells. They don't use the Mississippi. So that's exactly right. That's the suburban sprawl effect. And it was just cheaper. So they made the choice to sink wells. And water is managed by municipalities. That's the other weird thing about water. Drinking water is managed exclusively by municipalities. So if Woodbury does something, they have absolute authority to do almost anything they want. The Metro doesn't even get, the Metro Council has no control over them. They can advise, but they don't have control like they do over the transit system and the wastewater system. So every little municipality, and there's hundreds of, about 150 in the metro area, said, wells, great, we'll do it. Only two municipalities, the two big cities, are using the river. So this is a problem. Now, lesson number two, connection of surface water and groundwater. Who's not heard of White Bear Lake? Everyone has heard of White Bear Lake and the drawdown of the lake. And no matter what you've read in the papers or what your neighbors may have told you or what you may happen to believe, the science says that the drawdown of White Bear Lake is overdraw of the groundwater that feeds it. Every surface water feature in Minnesota has groundwater in it, including the Mississippi River. It starts from groundwater.
And so you draw too much from the groundwater that's feeding that surface water, it will go down. We have many examples of rivers going dry or reducing in volume and flow because of overuse of groundwater. So they are connected. They are one water system. Very different time frames, so it's hard to draw a nice little cycle. But this is a result of the suburbs around that area using too much groundwater. So they're connected. That's the lesson.
Well, what I've heard is that we have the same amount of water as the Earth has as it's always had. Mm-hmm. And so is it just the distribution then of the water?
To some extent, yes. So people, you know, those communities, there's what, four or five, you know, immediate communities that are drawing groundwater. And that's the same groundwater that feeds White Bear Lake. So if you're using more than you put back, White Bear Lake's going to go down. So you can't put it back fast enough.
But it's going someplace else.
Yes. Yes. In fact, that water is being drawn out by people, putting it in flush, going to the metro plant, and going down the Mississippi River.
Okay. So it doesn't disappear. It just goes.
No, we're shipping White Bear Lake essentially down the Mississippi River. That's pretty much the cycle. Good question. So the Met Council has done modeling. Again, they can't regulate the water supplies, but they can inform people. They try really hard to inform. And so they've informed by modeling into the future. And they've looked at scenarios up to 2030. And the metro area, by 2030, if we continue to use water the way we are, the red indicates we will have lost half of the height of the water in the groundwater. But we'll have gone down by more than 50%. This is a big red flag in the world of water, I'll just say, because these models are very uncertain. So when you get to the 50%, you're really getting very nervous, because if it's really 30% instead of 50%, you don't have a lot of room. And what would happen, these wells would go dry. They would have to dig deeper wells to the tune of enormous amounts of money. So, and the blue areas are in trouble. The red are they're in serious trouble. This is for 2030. That's not so far away when you think about it. And so there's a big push by the Met Council to get some communities, especially those in the northeast of the metro, to go on river water and not use groundwater. That's a political discussion. So let's talk about another issue, eutrophication. Does anyone know what that means? I apologize. I threw on this slide. I should have changed the wording specifically. But eutrophication, you want to define it for us?
Take your surface water and fill it in with the leaves and the dirt.
Okay, that works, but that's not what's happening with Minnesota, so quite the same way. So eutrophication, what I should have had up there is excess nutrients. So excess nutrients is phosphorus and nitrogen. Those are, anyone who gardens understands, you know, the NPK ratio, right? You gotta have your nitrogen, your phosphorus, and your potassium. We don't have a potassium problem, but we do have a nitrogen and a phosphorus problem because Minnesota is a major farm state. It's one of our biggest parts of our economy, and that is dominated by commodity crops, corn and soybeans. Corn needs to be fertilized to have full capacity and full production, and so we use a lot of fertilizer in agriculture. And then we also have livestock, and they produce a lot of animal poop. And that's a lot of phosphorus. We have phosphorus and nitrogen coming from urban runoff. Dog poop, leaves, all kinds of things can produce these nutrients. So you end up with excess nutrients in the water. As a result, excess phosphorus is what creates our problems with too much algal growth. You've seen lakes that turn green over the summer. That's algae, and that's because they have too much phosphorus. And you've probably also heard of harmful algal blooms, where you get a bloom in a certain lake or a river, and what happens is if those algae, for reasons that we don't understand and can't predict, they produce a toxin sometimes. Not always, that's why we can't predict it. These toxins, I mean, they'll kill dogs. You've probably seen the announcements where they say, don't walk your dog around Lake Minnetonka. Don't let your dog drink the water from, you know, Lake of the Isles, because they're having a bloom, and they know that it could kill. Dogs are
for whatever reason, particularly sensitive, as are loons, birds, and dogs. So it drives, okay, impaired waters. It's a legal term that means water that does not meet water quality standards set by the government and the state. The biggest reason Minnesota has impaired waters is because of excess nutrients. It comes from mostly from agriculture, and I'll show you some data, and it also comes from stormwater and other places. Phosphorus is key to fresh water. That's why it causes algae in lakes and rivers. Nitrogen causes the same problems in coastal regions, so the Chesapeake Bay problem that you might have heard of, the problem in the Gulf of Mexico, that is due to excess nitrogen, nitrates. But nitrates are super important in Minnesota as a public health problem. As anybody in public health knows, excess nitrates in drinking water can actually kill infants. So it's definitely something that we pay attention to. And then if you've got nitrates and they're mostly coming from agriculture practices, you're going to have bacteria from the animal poop. And you're going to also have erosion. You're going to have sediment. And you're going to have pesticides. They all co-vary. Okay? Now, impaired waters. This is a map of the state of Minnesota, and everything red and yellow is considered out of compliance with federal law. 40% of the state's waters is too polluted to meet federal standards. 40%. It's concentrated in the south, but you can see that there's even Lake Superior is not immune to this problem, mostly because of the harbor. So we have a problem here.
Yeah. Whose standards? Is it PCA what standards?
The US EPA sets the standards for, and then Minnesota can have stricter standards, but they can't have less strict standards than the federal. So it's a combination, but it's mostly EPA. Under the Clean Water Act. So where is this problem coming from? Is that it's mostly coming from excess nutrients. That's what the vast majority of that yellow and red is from. And actually, if you go back, you can see that it corresponds to our farming areas. So this is obviously where the corn and soybeans are grown, and then the agricultural area has spread up into the Red River Valley as well. We know where the phosphorus and nitrogen is coming from to our waters. Lots of work has been done to identify the sources, because if you don't know the source, you can't control the source. So for nitrogen, we know that 78% is coming from agriculture. It's fertilizer being applied to grow corn for the most part. Phosphorus, it's 40% from row crops. And I want to say it's one of these in addition is, nope, I combined them, okay. So 40% is agriculture, and then you have other sources for phosphorus. So that's there are many more sources of phosphorus than nitrogen. Nitrogen is mostly coming from agriculture, from the use of fertilizer. What has happened as a result of this is we do have contaminated drinking water. So again, bringing it back to this public health issue, if you weren't thinking about agriculture and because you're a public health person and you live in the city and you just really don't care, you just want to eat your corn and eat your beef, and don't worry about it. There are some real things going on in the state of Minnesota as a result of this over-fertilization using nitrate. Public wells, okay, so the dots, I should explain the dots. Red means that well is out of compliance. It's got water in it that can kill children. And the yellow means it's within an order of magnitude. Okay, the standard is 10, it means it's 3 or over. So this is the public well system. There's a bunch of red dots on there. So what do those cities have to do? They have to blend their water. They have to drill another well and blend it to bring down the contamination. If they can't do that, they have to build a treatment plant to remove the nitrate. This is required by law, absolute federal law. There's no gray about drinking water and how it's managed. And Minnesota follows the rules very carefully. So down in here, for instance, they have to build a treatment plant to remove the nitrate. They can't get enough clean water to dilute the contaminated water with. I want to say St. Peter. I'm not good with pointing. St. Peter had to do the same thing. They built a nitrate removal plant. But this is an indication of the source water and its contamination. The middle is private wells. I drink private well water. I have a private well. Who has a private well? Who drinks well water? Most of you are city water people, huh? Okay, well, you don't have a nitrate problem because the city, the municipalities are very good about controlling for that. But look at this. This is amazing. This is finished water at the tap. And it's not regulated. The federal government doesn't regulate private water. So you can drink contaminated water if you want. You can poison your grandchildren, go right ahead. Not a problem if it's private. But we don't want to. But most people don't know because it's not required to be tested. So if talk to your neighbors and friends about this one, but this is a very alarming graph. And then we have rivers and streams are also, these are groundwater wells. These are rivers and streams. So we have problems throughout Minnesota as a result of nitrates. All right, third issue I wanted to mention, contaminants of emerging concern. Who's heard this phrase? Okay. So contaminants of emerging concern are essentially, so the federal government regulates about 100 chemicals. About 5 of them cause the red and yellow on the map. Okay? So we focus on those 5. We call those the conventional pollutants, conventional because they're regulated. Unconventional pollutants are essentially those that aren't regulated. And there's hundreds of them that we know to be in our water supply, but we don't know exactly what the impact is on human health or on animal health. And so they aren't regulated through our traditional risk assessment process. There are hundreds of them. They're mostly what are pharmaceuticals. Lots of them are pharmaceuticals. And then we also have something called endocrine disruptors. And these are chemicals that can behave like hormones. They can mimic growth hormones or developmental hormones or thyroid hormones or reproductive hormones, et cetera. But they're not supposed to be in your body. So there are some concerns about that. And then we know they're found everywhere. Minnesota has measured much of the state's water supply, and we absolutely have them in our water supply. Where do they come from? All over the place. These chemicals can be found in our food containers, especially in tin cans. They can be found in everyday products such as makeups and cosmetics and lotions. They can be found in everyday home cleaning products. They are obviously pharmaceuticals, I already mentioned that, so any kind of pharmaceutical is a potential source, especially birth control pills, which are absolutely a hormone mimic. And then you have industrial sources. You also have some current use pesticides, which are endocrine disruptors. We know that livestock, there's a lot of pharmaceuticals used in livestock that gets into our water supply. And so they come all over the place. They come from all those different sources. But why do we care? We know they cause problems. We just don't know how much of a problem. We know they interfere with reproduction. We know they interfere with growth. We know they interfere with development. We know they interfere with organ health. We know they contribute to some of our what we call epidemics, public health epidemics of obesity and heart disease. We know they contribute to behavioral problems as children develop. And we know they affect the next generation. So they may not affect you. You could be drinking this water and say, hey, I'm good, I'm fine. But your children may not be, because they were exposed in utero. We don't know the magnitude. I can say that it affects those things, but we don't know the magnitude, so we can't regulate it. And to remove hundreds of chemicals without having proof, that's not the way our regulatory system works. So, are they in our drinking water? This is a survey that covers about a third of the United States population. And they found in this study 11 compounds all the time. 9 of them are drugs, over-the-counter as well as prescription. So these things are in the water supply. Do we know they cause problems? I'll just give you an example. The way we found these chemicals initially was because they cause problems in wildlife, mostly in fish. So this is a study. It's the United States map in the background. Major river basins are shown in the outline. So here's the Mississippi River Basin, MRB. And they went downstream in major parts of those river systems, and they collected fish, 14 different species of fish. And they found what's called intersects at 31% of the sites across the nation. One third of the fish had intersects. What does that mean? Both testes and ovaries. Can't reproduce, not natural, not normal, not a good thing. The background level of intersects from museum samples is more like 3%. So have we affected the fish in our nation's rivers? Yeah, 31% of them. Not all species were affected. So it's the science is fascinating, because we only two species showed this level of intersects. Some species showed none. Okay, moving to the next couple of issues. Hydrologic and ecological changes. So how we've changed the hydrologic cycle has affected how we've changed the ecology of our system. So we've increased impervious surfaces, so we've increased runoff, horizontal runoff instead of going into the groundwater. We tile most of our agricultural land, meaning we drain the land as quickly as we can, we collect that water in pipes, and we let it then flow into receiving ditches and rivers, but that it's a very fast movement of water. It's not the normal cycle, so we've accelerated the hydrologic cycle with tiling. We've drained a lot of our wetlands. I'll show you a picture of that. We've lost a lot of habitat as a result, because by losing our wetlands, we've lost a lot of bird habitat and fish habitat and other wildlife habitat. And then we have introduced invasive species, which is not helpful. So if you look at how land use has changed in Minnesota, this is 1890. That's 1990. This is prairie. Yellow, it's missing. We took our prairies and we turned them into agricultural land. That's why we are such an important state, because we grow so much corn in that wonderful place. Fabulous soils, but we had to get rid of the prairies, and we had to drain the wetlands to do that. So that's how different the state looks in terms of land use. I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm saying there are implications and consequences for doing this. In the south part of the state, 90% of the wetlands were drained. That was a very marshy area, marshy prairie area. This is Kaneohe County. Every pink area on here is a wetland that was drained. So you can see the extent. It's just astonishing when you know, a picture is worth 1,000 words. In the north, the wetland draining was much less. But overall in the state, about 50% of the state's wetlands were drained and are no longer wetlands. So that's land use issues. And we can talk about some of these other things. I'm throwing out a whole lot of information here. But we talked about the water energy nexus. This is what I talked about earlier. This is cooling water to generate electricity. Here we're using water to generate biofuels by growing corn in Minnesota, turning it into ethanol for fuels. And then we also use a ton of energy to clean our drinking water and to clean our sewage. So they're all intermingled. Water and energy are completely and totally intermingled. Water infrastructure. So you've heard about Flint, right? Everybody's heard about Flint. You may have heard some of these numbers, but I'll say Minnesota, which is one of the more responsibly minded states. We take care of our water and our citizens and our things better than most states. However, we have the same problem in Minnesota. This is how much money is available for infrastructure up to 2020. And this is the need for upgrading our infrastructure. And this is in, as you can see, hundreds of millions of dollars. And that's just a four-year period. So we need a lot. In fact, it's been estimated that by 2035, Minnesota alone will need $10 billion. And the country's going to need about $15 trillion. Where's it going to come from? This comes from the feds already. It's not like we're not getting our tax dollars returned to us, but there's this shortfall. Why is that? Clean Water Act came in 1970. It said, you got to treat your sewage. You can't just dump it into the river and the lake. Oh, okay. People had to build sewage treatment plants. They all were built between 1970 and 1980. They're all getting old at the same time. It's like a balloon payment on a mortgage. We're all coming due. All those plants need upgrades. So that's what's happening. That's why this is so huge. Okay, I've peppered you with all these issues. I haven't really said much about solving them. We can talk about that. But I wanted you to try to appreciate how they come together and how they impact public health. So, the overuse of groundwater, it affects surface water. It obviously affects the, how much water we can access for drinking water. So it reduces supply, but it also concentrates contamination. You take a gallon of water and you reduce it to a half a gallon of water. The contaminants in it just doubled in concentration. So if you start to do this, you start to contaminate the aquifers even more. So groundwater, most people don't think about groundwater. It's clean, it's out there, it's under the ground, it's fine. Wrong. It has a great deal to do with our water supply and many other things. The birds and fish in White Bear Lake aren't so happy either. In terms of, and that's an important point. So White Bear Lake is a lesson in drinking water access, the misuse of groundwater, but also the recreational use of that lake has been highly affected. The property values plummeted. There's all kinds of social issues that are connected to that simple thing about how surface water and groundwater are connected. Agricultural practice. Again, this is probably the biggest problem that the state faces. It's without a doubt the biggest problem that the nation faces. And for a variety of reasons. But it has to do with basically having excess contamination from excess nutrients, the phosphorus, and mostly with nitrates. The phosphorus is causing the harmful algal blooms. You might recall that Toledo, the city of Toledo, had its water supply shut down for a week, two summers ago. That was harmful algal blooms in Lake Erie. The entire city had to stop providing drinking water like in 1 second. They had to turn off the taps to the entire city. 300,000 people stopped getting their drinking water. Bingo. Because of that. Contaminants of emerging concern, obviously it's a public health issue, but it's also an ecological issue. Hydrologic changes, by draining those wetlands, we've reduced the capacity of the natural cleansing capacity of water as it flows through a wetland. The nitrates are reduced, the phosphorus is reduced, the bacteria is reduced by natural processes. And by getting rid of our wetlands, we've really reduced that natural capacity. In terms of energy, we use a lot of energy, and we have to think about that. We don't have a national energy policy, really. We just definitely don't have a national water policy. But they need to be done together. Otherwise, they'll be at cross purposes. We could build nitrate removal plants across the whole state. Cost a lot of money, but okay, say we could do that. No more nitrate problems. They use energy. They use a ton of energy because they use reverse osmosis. So if we were to try to remove nitrates in every part of the state that has a problem, our energy bill would go up like this. We'd probably have to build energy plants, not reduce them. Infrastructure needs. I didn't talk about pricing, but it's an economic challenge of how to correctly price water. And of the 150 municipalities just in the metro area, they have 150 different pricing policies. Not so smart. So that's an issue. But this is my bottom line take-home message. To protect public health, you have to have a sustainable water supply. That may seem like totally self-evident, but to have a sustainable water supply, you have to address quantity and quality, you have to address surface and groundwater, and you have to address ecosystem use just as much as public health use. So it all comes together. How can you help? I'm gonna just put these up. Learn, you're here today learning. Vote, you can't imagine how much the legislators respond to people contacting them and voting. Join groups. Monitor your own local water. Volunteer monitors are in great demand by the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency. Advocate for water. It's not a political issue. It's not a partisan issue. It's not an anything issue. It's everybody's issue. Advocate for it. Contribute, whether it's time, money, energy, your brain, contribute. Teach your neighbors and friends. Clean up your local river, stream, stormwater drain. Take the time to enjoy water. We don't do that enough either. In Minnesota, we do a pretty good job, but pick your favorite water place in your mind. Close your eyes. You can go there. It's great. Build or create a sense of community around that water body. Care, obviously you're here. And imagine a future where we do all of that. Thank you. Okay. Yes, and I guess I'm hard of hearing. I'm just gonna
Why did you put nitrates in our food as preservatives?
Say
Because they work, they do, they help preserve, but those nitrates are an additional source of nitrates. So hot dogs, most hot dogs have nitrates, that's a good example. Bacon has nitrates in it. The adults can process those nitrates in their stomach and then with various enzymes. Children, especially those infants less than 6 months, are not developed enough to process those nitrates. And they, what they do is they replace oxygen on hemoglobin, and they literally, it's called blue baby syndrome, those children suffer.
Is my cause cancer of intestine? Cancer of the intestine?
There is some concern about nitrates and cancer. It's that's, I think, still being researched quite heavily because the mechanism is unclear. But it's a concern because of the nitrates in the drinking water for the adults. Because that's probably more, you're getting more nitrates there than you are from eating a hot dog. So the water source is actually.
Some people, they eat hot dogs every day, 3 times a day.
I suppose.
Or smoked food, sausages, bacon, that is the source of this chemical.
Yeah. No, it's a concern because of the potential. It's also a concern that nitrates are an endocrine disruptor, not just a carcinogen. So there's a lot of issues with nitrates.
So if EPA isn't regulating private well water, are there any states or other jurisdictions that are regulating it in a way that would be good to be replicated?
No, there is no state that regulates private reasonable use of private water on your land. So the ground under the water under you, you may have to buy those water rights or buy them or sell them separately, but the water under your land is yours to use for reasonable use, which means you can have a well and drink that water. You can't irrigate because that's too much water. So that's an example where reasonable use means for home use. Because the United States is based on firm belief in private property rights, there is no state that regulates your use of that groundwater. The rights may be separate from the surface rights, like mineral rights can be separated from your ownership of the land, but it's not regulated in terms of quality. The only way to get around it is to essentially educate and require people to test well water at the time of sale, or refinance, or purchase, something that triggers a test like you would for any other kind of inspection. I mean, we have zoning laws and we have inspection laws for selling houses. You could build it into that. The world of realtors has decided that would be onerous, and so they fight tooth and nail to prevent Minnesota from passing such a law. We've tried a couple times. Wish they all drank well water. They might change their minds, but as a lobbying group, they have fought against that. That's the only way to get at it. There is no state that doesn't, because we value private property rights.
On the private wells, when their new ones are constructed, a requirement to sample that is required of a well contractor and ask them, good, that's the only time it's even required to test.
That's correct.
Contact your local county health department, or if you're living in a municipality, the health department, they can help facilitate that testing.
Absolutely. Yep. So if you want to, if you're looking at your, but me and you drink well water, yeah, you go to your county health department. They'll tell you where you have to go and what you want.
As you look at the nitrate problem in the state, how much is that related to where we've got a more susceptible groundwater system because of karst formation or something where it's surface water more quickly flows into the groundwater?
So the data on the private wells was obtained voluntarily, and it was done with a combination of the health department and the Department of Agriculture, the State Department of Agriculture, went to the areas that they know would be the most susceptible. Shallow wells, those with the central sand plains, the karst region in the southeast of the state, those are very susceptible to groundwater contamination because it's very high drainage rates, sandy soil or calcified soil, and the wells are shallow. So they concentrated their volunteer efforts in those areas. They got really good participation. But they didn't go, for instance, up to Arrowhead because Arrowhead, basically is no groundwater. People don't drink much groundwater up there. So they haven't focused on that, so you don't see any dots up there. So yes, it's, it,
they did their study based on looking for the most susceptible areas, and that's absolutely true. Not all parts of the state are equal.
Yeah, I would say that they are leaking underground storage tanks. Mm-hmm. Is there any data on that, how it affects the groundwater?
Yes, so any kind of septic system, if it isn't maintained and it isn't operating periodically, it
gas emissions?
That's a source of oil and gas, and that's highly regulated. In underground storage tanks for oil and gasoline are highly regulated. Not to say they don't occur, but there's a whole section of law on that, under the Swackhamer law. But septic tanks, again, it gets into this public-private thing, because most septic tanks are on private land. So counties have regulated to some extent. I live in Washington County. They recommend cleaning your septic, you know, having pumps every 3 years. There's no way to test for compliance on that. There's no accountability. It's just a recommendation, and that's about as good as it gets, I think. And old septic systems are a huge source of sewage leakage into groundwater, and so that's going to be a problem in the state. At one point, it was thought that 50% of the septics in the state were out of compliance and causing pollution. That number is now, the state put a huge, big effort at working with that, and the number is now thought to be about less than 20%. The reason I'm saying about is because there is actually no accountability. No one has to report septics. There's no one who counts septics or puts them on a map, oddly enough. One of the private property. So.
I don't know if it's so much a problem in Minnesota, but what about feedlots and that causing the
regulations. Yep. So feedlots are regulated by the US EPA through the Clean Water Act. If you have a large feedlot, and it has to be large enough that it's over 1,000 animal units, which is about a pig, so over 1,000 pigs or about 800 cattle or 10,000 chickens, that adds up to a certain weight. Then it's called a feedlot, and it's regulated by the federal government. And you have to manage your manure, you have to properly dispose of your manure, or age it, or compost it before you use, et cetera. So there's rules around large animal operations. But the smaller operations are not regulated. The state of Minnesota used to have additional regulations, and the legislature has gone back and forth between passing the law and then rescinding it, passing it, rescinding it. So at the moment, we're in the rescinding phase. There is no regulation of smaller animal operations. We are not a big livestock state. I mean, people that live near a live or CAFO would beg to differ. That's not a problem, but it's that's not only from a statewide perspective. It's the row crops, which are a problem in Minnesota. You go to Kansas or Nebraska, I mean, then you're going to get into Colorado, huge livestock problems. But they're regulated. Row crop agriculture is not regulated under the So if you're a farmer and there's no regulation that says I don't have to worry about polluting, that's not what they don't want. There's no restrictions on their actions that might lead to pollution. And if without those restrictions, they're going to make the money they can make. They're a business. So without a regulation to force their behavior to be truncated, a speed limit. they can do what they want. And that's one of the problems that makes this so intractable, is that nitrate pollution throughout the country is a problem, and it's because there are very few ways to control it and manage it without a regulatory structure. Yes?
It's great, actually. You raised a very important question. Farmers in Minnesota is a farmer's land. And it's actually the Department of Agriculture required farmers to use fertilizer in order to protect them from losses. So they buy insurance. So insurance can compensate their losses.
Actually,
so in order to get insurance, yes, in order to get that compensation, they require to use fertilizer. That is about Minnesota and government.
Yeah, it's not that
actually contribute to pollution, for the pollution, because it's required by government.
It's very complicated, because the Farm Bill has run the farmer's life. If you're a row crop guy and you're growing corn or soybeans or wheat or one of the other five commodities, you're going to do this to maximize your benefit from the farm bill. And the farm bill doesn't really care so much about water. So if there's a big disconnect between our farm policy and our food policy and our water policy, even though they're totally related, it takes water to grow food.
Yeah,
there's no doubt. But the farm bill is where that disincentives and the misdirected incentives come from, is largely from the farm bill, and that affects Minnesota a lot.
To what extent could desalinization of water help Arizona and California in water issues?
Yep, that's a great question. So desalinization is a great technology. It takes seawater, it removes the salt, and then you've got fresh water. So that's what it does. It uses reverse osmosis, which is very energy intensive, and you still then have that concentrated brine to get rid of, but it's a good technology. Most of the water in Israel, for instance, is desalinated water. I just was in the Caribbean for almost a month, and most of the Caribbean islands use desalinated water for obvious reasons. They don't have any other water, and they use that works. In California, the biggest desalinization plant to be built in the United States, actually it's finished now, the biggest plant in the United States was built in San Diego, just finished this year. It's the biggest in the country. It's huge. It's enormous. It's going to supply 7% of San Diego's water needs. 7. Not 50, not... So to fix the problem in California is almost numerically impossible to do just solely through desalination. Is it part of a tool in the toolbox? Absolutely. But is it the answer? Absolutely not. Yeah. Arizona also they don't do any desal because they don't have enough source of water to do that, but they do a lot of water recycling. So they take wastewater and turn it back into potable water. They're probably the leader. I would say the state of Arizona has the best emulator system I can compare. California does it to some extent, but Arizona does it better. They regulate it nicely, it's safe, it works. That's probably a better answer than desalinization.
With the treatment plants where you're removing nitrogen, you're removing salt, where does the excess salt?
The salt.
Or the nitrogen, or the phosphorus, or
yeah,
taking away all this to make clean.
Yep, so they have to dispose of it in some way. So for desal plants, they take that salt and they dump it back in the ocean. So there are consequences to that, you're sure, because it...
Yeah, so some purify the salt are selling to people. They purify it.
It can be, but only if they have a market for it and they want to buy it.
Yeah,
so
Africa,
San Diego plants, they're siphoning it out into the coastal waters.
And the nitrogen, where does that end up back on the ground?
Actually, they denitrify, turn it back into nitrogen gas. So the nitrogen has got a very complicated cycle. Most of our air is nitrogen, so 78% of what we breathe is nitrogen gas. And so nitrate is a bad thing all by itself. It's part of that nitrogen cycle. We disrupted that cycle by having so much nitrate. Microbes, bacteria, good bacteria, or make that cycle happen, and so they denitrify, they turn that nitrate back into nitrogen gas.
So with an increase in aquaculture then, is that
one way to really take removed nitrate and then have like a separate plant that would actually be like a bacterial, like a bio plant. And some plants have done this. The plant, sewage plant up in Duluth, for instance, the WLSSD, Western Lake Superior Sanitary District. It does both Duluth and Superior. And they have a denitrifier processing as well as a sewage removal system. So they're trying to take advantage of that. So there are ways to treat that. But they cost more money, and there's a cost to everything. So one way to, like Europe has done this, they have decentralized their sewage treatments. So they have these huge, giant plants that are treating huge amounts of sewage back to potable water so that you can use it to wash your car. It's not very effective or efficient, I should say. They actually have much smaller plants, and they deal with these
basically rebuild our sewage treatment plant in two things, solids and to remove phosphorus. And that's what they're there for. But we've got hundreds of other things to remove now, so they're not, they don't remove those very well. So it's, we have to kind of rethink our technology. I think I'm heading into my, networking session up in the campus club. I'm happy to keep going with questions here. I'm going to wander up to the campus club at some point, but I don't want to keep you if you're anxious to go upstairs. So feel free to go up to the fourth floor.
Okay.